Novels usually begin with a line that indicates a story is about to unfold. And here's an example that I particularly like from Kurt Vonnegut. What I want to do tonight is I want to tell you a story about an idea. The idea is both old and new. And as a neuroscientist, I would phrase the idea something like this. An important way to understand how literature works is to look at how it interacts with the mind and the brain. Particular form of art that I want to talk about tonight is literary art. Now, when I first thought about introducing this topic, I thought about coming at it from sort of general ideas of literature and neuroscience, but in fact, I decided recently that I have to come at it from a more personal angle. About 9 months ago, my sister had a massive stroke, and she's partially paralyzed, and she's been struggling every day since to regain basic functions. Several weeks ago, she told me that for the first time since the stroke, she had actually experienced an interest in reading, and she'd picked up a novel. Now, because there's recent evidence that reading, and especially reading of fiction, has important impacts on brain and behavior, I believe that my sister's reemergence into the world of the novel is actually a great sign of recovery. So what happens inside your brain when you read a great novel, short story, or maybe a poem? Well, it turns out that the most interesting answer to that, I think, was delivered about 90 years ago. And it didn't come from the sciences. It came from the humanities. In 1924, a professor of literary studies, who had a very big impact on the study of literature in the 20th century, I.A. Richards, put forth his ideas about literature. He wrote a major book called The Principles of Literary Criticism. He was a professor at Cambridge University and later in his career also at Harvard. In The Principles, I.A. Richards indicated that in order to understand the power of literary art, that one had to actually consider developing a theory of psychology. Now, that's a bold statement, but it was a necessary one, because at the time, the psychology of literature, of aesthetics, and even of cognition itself was very poorly developed. So Richards went on to develop a very detailed neuropsychological model of how one reads and reacts to literature. As his example, he used a line of poetry. And here's the model. Now, when I first saw this model, I was sort of stopped dead in my tracks. It's amazing. It's beautiful. It has a cellular level of detail to it. And if you look at it and you're a neuroscientist, you immediately see hints of the structure of the cerebral cortex. Where did this model come from? Hold that thought. What Richards does in this model is he shows you at the line atop a line of poetry. And the poetry is taken in through the eye and then visually processed through neural networks and through a series of mental operations that he defines below. The first step in this process is that the line of text is processed visually in the upper layer. And you'll notice that the way it's processed is in discrete chunks. This is incredibly realistic. When we scan a line of text, our eyes don't move along it smoothly. In fact, it jumps from spot to spot. And when we pause and focus on something, we can only see an area that's about 1 to 2 words wide. So, beyond the visual recognition of word forms that's suggested in this first layer, Richards went on to suggest that there's a series of operations that take place, including to connect to related sensory images from memory, to connect to more distant associations in memory, and finally here, connect to emotional reactions. Now, Richards' use of this highly detailed graphical model and all the specific details of it, which I don't have time to go into, foreshadowed just about where cognitive neuroscience has arrived today on the question of how do we read and react to literature. So, What I want you to do now is I want you to think about what happens during processing of literature. So I'm showing you here the brain of an author and the brain of a reader. In taking in literature, we might go to a simple model that comes from basic neurology, and that would be that the words and the phrases of the literature are processed in the classic language areas, which are shown here kind of schematically in red. However, recent brain scan studies have actually shown that in addition, reading directly activates lots of areas that were thought of as very far removed from that related to language. So for example, some studies have looked at verbs, some at adjectives, and a comparison of these studies would look something like this. Action words not only activate the classical language areas, but in addition, they activate areas of the motor cortex. So for example, the word kick might activate a region of the brain that's actually normally turned on when you move your leg. Sensory words can activate parts of the sensory cortex. And so for example, a description of, say, the fuzz on a peach might activate an area of the sensory cortex that would normally be turned on when you're processing texture. So more generally, what we found is the following, that outside the language areas, there's constant activation of numerous sensorimotor circuits, and also circuits for emotion and circuits for memory. So there's an awful lot to be said about what's going on here, and the issue is really to figure out what's the best way to study this. Well, we just went through some brain scans, and brain scans are very pretty, but they're not the whole answer to everything. In fact, one needs to also consider upward levels like behavior. The brain is the organ of behavior, and lower levels like the cells of the brain. Now, an area where this is being done recently, and to some great effect, is the study of memory. Now, if you want to appreciate the impact of cognition from reading, Keith Oatley, who's both a psychologist and a novelist, has recently suggested in his wonderful book on the psychology of fiction a simple test. Give folks a short story and ask them to write in the margins every time they have a cognitive reaction, a flash of memory, an emotional response. So I did this with a group of volunteers, and I was very surprised at the immediacy and the consistency with which memory reactions were evoked. Now, Richards would not have been surprised at this, because back in 1924, he said, there is no kind of mental activity in which memory does not intervene. That's a provocative statement. It's a very contemporary statement. So let's look at some recent cellular studies of memory. There's a group headed by Itzhak Fried that's done many, many studies recently of memory and looked at its relationship to perception and to language. And what they found is that they recorded from people that were undergoing therapeutic neurosurgery, and in the period just before the surgery, they have to undergo some observations, and they were willing to be implanted with a number of wires so that you could record the natural electrical signals of their brain. What they found was that in the medial temporal lobe, there were these amazingly complex cells that would respond to each of any number of very complicated inputs related to the same concept. In this case, this is a cell I'm showing you that would respond to seeing the word Oprah written. That same cell would also respond if it just heard Oprah spoken. That same cell would also respond if the image of Oprah was presented. Now, this is naturally occurring in this person's brain, so this person must be a fan of Oprah's. But this person would also have lots of other cells that would respond to people or objects that are important to them. They might have cells responding to their sister. They might have cells responding to their soccer coach. So these studies went even further because they looked at memory. After these recordings were made, the individuals had a rest period, and then they came back and they talked about things. And if they freely recalled some of the memories from the first session they were in, and if this person talked about or thought about Oprah, this same cell would start to fire, just in the same way it had during the original perceptual experience. And this happens with all these cells. So, what does this tell us? It tells us that sometimes words can trigger very complicated multisensory remembrances. It also tells us that to remember something is actually to re-experience it or to relive it. That's a very powerful notion. What I want to do now is move from memory to the idea that the specific effects of fiction, because that's something that's really important and near and dear to my heart and has impacted my sister. I should say, by the way, that the whole idea that you evoke memories while you're reading, to me, is important because it raises the question, as you read and you evoke your own reactions, does that merge with what you're reading? It also raises the question of what kind of cognitive dispositions we have that might be influenced by the act of reading. So I think these studies I'm going to show you on fiction will address that. Several groups have done these experiments, and one of the things they found first was that people who read fiction and were given stories with an uncanny or absurdist plot actually, when tested afterward, had an increased ability to detect unusual patterns compared to controls who read normal stories. Another group found that people who frequently read fiction compared to those who frequently read nonfiction were much better at tests in recognizing social and emotional cues. And finally, another experiment showed that by testing before and after reading, that after reading fiction, people experienced a lower need for cognitive closure. And to psychologists, a low need for cognitive closure is what characterizes highly creative people. So, what we have here is mounting empirical evidence that literature has enduring effects on brain and subsequent behavior. Now, the very idea of bringing empiricism to some aspects of literary study is, should I say, not without its critics. But here it's helpful to actually go back to the futuristic thinking of I.A. Richards. From whence did Richards get his amazing, prescient ideas about brain, mind, and literary imagination? Where did he get that amazing model? Well, his ideas were his own, clearly. The model, well, it's in the Principles in 1924, but there's no attribution to it. But he later told his biographer, well, I just translated Shelley into Sherrington. This is Sherrington, Charles Scott Sherrington. He was a Nobel laureate for physiology or medicine in 1932. He was a student at Cambridge University and also an honorary fellow, and of course, that's where Richards taught. Sherrington got his Nobel for landmark studies on the information processing of central nervous system cells. He also, by the way, published on the structure of the cerebral cortex. And almost certainly, this is where Richards got his, at least, inspiration for an anatomically oriented model of reading. So, there's a lot of lessons here. One of the things I think that's important is to think about the overall effect of this in an intellectual sense. And I'd phrase it this way, that the intellectual confluence between these two individuals led to Richards making a pretty dramatic statement that the mysteries of literary art should actually be open to investigation by empirical techniques, but not to the exclusion of traditional humanistic approaches of reflection on things like meaning and value and aesthetics. So this has an incredibly important lesson for us here about the value of us getting out of our own disciplines, and an incredibly important message about the powerful interaction between the humanities and the sciences. Richard said a long time ago, a book is a machine to think with. Now, as we feel increasing pressure to train ever more students in science and in technology, I hope we will remember that literary art is naturally inclined to stimulate the brain, engage the memory, and engage the imagination. My sister will, I hope, continue to stimulate her brain and heal her brain with daily doses of that wonderful cognitive stimulation we call the novel. So, my closing slide here is a quote from Virginia Woolf. It's one I kind of like. "Yes," she thought, laying down her brush in extreme fatigue, "I've had my vision." Thank you very much for listening to me.